front line. Good morning. Thank you for joining us. If you're in the lobby, go ahead and make your way in here. And if you're online, thank you so much for tuning in and joining us. If you guys would like to stand up and greet the people around you, get to know some new faces.
Morning. We're so privileged and honored to be able to start singing the song that's been going on for forever.
Sing it out.
I won't stop singing.
Surrender. Some other words that we could use for surrender is to lay down, give up, give in. And there's something special about being in this place of worship with people who all are seeking after the same thing. And sometimes it's hard to let go and surrender. So I just encourage you to use this opportunity to dive into that.
Sing this together. Is there before creation eternity in your hand? You spoke the earth into motion, my soul now to stand. So I walk upon
Amen. Amen. What a beautiful song of surrender that we get to sing this morning. What can I say? What can I do but offer my heart, oh God, completely to you? What a beautiful thing. And I don't know what you have brought here this morning, what you've been walking through in your day-to-day life. But I'm going to pray for us in just a second, and I would just encourage you. I would invite you in, because I feel like the Lord is inviting us in to lay before him whatever you've brought, whatever's heavy on your heart, whatever you're going through in your life, and surrender it to him, to give it to him, because in his hands is the best and safest place for it to be. So I'm going to pray, and I invite you to think about that and to lay it before him at this morning. Would you pray with me? Father, I am so grateful that you have blessed us, but Lord, we remember that all we have is yours. And so God, we completely surrender our hearts to you, God. We completely surrender whatever's going on in our life. Whatever we're facing, whatever we need wisdom for, whatever situation we're going through, God, it is yours. We give it to you today, because in your hands is the best place for it to be. And Lord, would we walk in that freedom today? Would we leave a little lighter than when we came in? Because we know that we don't have to carry heavy burdens by ourselves, that is in your hands, that you carry those things for us, and we are grateful for that today, God. We are so grateful. And so we give that to you, and we trust that. And in the powerful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Well, good morning, Frontline. Good morning. My name is Mariah, and I'm the student pastor here, and I've just got a couple of things to keep you in the loop of what's going on at Frontline. So our first announcement is just to let you know that if you're new here, welcome. We're so glad that you're here, and we want to get you connected. And one of the best ways that we think to get you connected is for you to join us at one of our newcomers lunches. So we have that going on next Sunday after second service. We have a newcomers lunch, and what that is we just basically tell you all you need to know about Frontline, give you information about our church, and then give you ways to get plugged in, whether that's in a small group or serving or just getting you connected with other people at the church. So if you're new, we'd love for you to join us for that. And if you could, just let us know that you're coming. So how you register for that is on frontlinegr.com/newcomerslunch. So just let us know that you're coming, and we'd love to have you join us after second service next Sunday. The second thing I've got for you is on October 22nd, y'all, I'm so excited, we have marriage night. So we have a date night opportunity for you. You do not want to miss out on this. It's going to be so great. It's going to be funny. There's going to be activities. There's going to be prizes. It's going to be awesome, y'all. So it's a simulcast put on by Right Now Media. The speakers are going to be amazing. It'll be a great way for you to connect with other couples, and y'all are not going to want to miss this. So Cody and I are going to be there. We cannot wait, and we can't wait to see you. And our final thing that I got to tell you about is not like the least or anything, because I'm really excited about that too, is our night of worship. And that's on November 11th, 11/11, so you can remember. And our night of worship is just going to be here at Frontline, but it's not just for our church, it's for the Zero Collective. So there's going to be our sister churches are joining us as well, which will be awesome. And if you enjoy worship here on Sunday morning, y'all, I can't get enough, I know it, then you're going to love this. And it's just on a Thursday night. It's at 6:30, and there's childcare provided for kindergarten and under. But for older kids, they're welcome to come and join you for worship. And it's going to be a powerful night, and you are not going to want to miss that. So 11/11 at 6:30, night of worship. And as we transition into our time of tithes and offerings, I just want to let you know that there are four ways for you to give, and that's right here on the screen behind me. And I just want to thank you so much for the generosity that I've seen time and time again of this church. And I just want to thank you for the yes that you've said, and the yes to God that you've said about giving faithfully. Because I know that when we step out in faith and we say yes to the Lord, he's able to take that and bless it and multiply it in ways that we can't even imagine in our community. So thank you so much for how you've been partnering in our community and being the hands and feet of Jesus, truly. So I'm going to pray for us. I'm going to pray over the tithe and offering, and then pray for us as we move into the time of the message. So, Lord, I'm just so grateful for your goodness and for the ways that you have blessed us. And Lord, I am grateful for the people in this room that have said yes to you and have been stepped out in faith and have been obedient with their giving, God. And that we have just seen that you have moved and that you've moved powerfully in this community. And because of some of the people that have said yes, you are able to do that. And so we're grateful today. We're grateful for what you're doing. And we pray that you would continue to do even more. And Lord, I pray for David as he comes and brings the message, Lord, would our hearts and our ears be open to what you have to say. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, hey, good morning, Frontline. How are we doing in the room today? Pretty good, good. It's good to see you. It's really exciting to start off a brand new series today all about marriage. So welcome. Glad that you're here, especially if it's your first time. And then we just want to say welcome. We're glad that you're here and watching online or listening later. It's just good to have you. Can't wait to jump in. So we're just going to get right to it. Sometimes isn't it true that our idea of what marriage will look like actually clashes with reality? Amen. Oftentimes what we step into, particularly or specifically in marriage, it's different than what we anticipate. So I want to tell you a story. Story goes like this. It's an old Italian man. His favorite thing in the world is cookies, but he's on his deathbed. So he's dying. He's approaching the end. He knows he's like in his final hours or days. Like he's there. His health is declining. And his wife of 60 years, I mean, they've just done this journey together. So as he's upstairs in his bedroom, all of a sudden, he gets this whiff of his all-time favorite cookie that he's ever had. And it's called the Italian Anisette Sprinkle Cookie. And so as he's in his bed, he smells it and he goes, "Are you kidding me? My wife must love me so much that she wants me to die a happy man." So what does he do? He musters all of his energy, all of his strength. He gets out of bed. He moves to the stairwell. He's clutching and gripping and holding tightly to the railing. He gets to the bottom. He stumbles, but he's making his way to the kitchen. At this point, it's like his strength is so zapped, he's like crawling. And as he walks or as he crawls into the kitchen, he sees in front of him there over this table, like over their kitchen table, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of these cookies, the Italian Anisette Sprinkle Cookies. I mean, they're perfect. They're warm. It's like they're so tangible, like he can taste them. And as he's getting closer and closer, he's just thinking, like, my wife is so amazing. She loves me so much. And as he reaches up on the table to grab one of the cookies, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, a spatula smacks him in the hand, and it's his wife. And she says, "Back off. Those are for the funeral." Can anybody that's married relate? Did you marry somebody that's like that or not? I don't know. Here's what I just want to say. Sometimes our idea of what marriage will look like clashes with reality. Amen? There's a lot more amens after that story, right? You go, you know what? I have something like that in my marriage, men and women, mind you. So we're going to dive in. I can't wait. Maybe your marriage did not turn out the way that you expected. Some of you, maybe you never got married, but you thought you would. Some of you, your marriage ended a lot earlier than you anticipated. Some of you encountered tragedy that could not have been foreseen. Some of you have been married multiple times. Some of you have desired to, but just haven't. It's like time and time and time again, it just doesn't work out. The wheels fall off. It just falls apart. So many of us, our experience of marriage is different than what we perceived it to be. And so we're going to dive in. This is going to be a fun series. I'm just going to tell you ahead of time. It's actually going to provide a ton of value for you, whether you're married or single. In fact, we care so much about this series, we actually have a sermon totally devoted to singleness, because marriage is meant to be a metaphor that points to and directs our attention to something greater. So whether you're single, married, divorced, married for a couple years, married for a lot of years, widowed, whatever it is, this series can add value to your life. And that's why I'm so excited about it. But the question we need to tackle and the question that we're going to start with, it goes like this. What does God's idea for marriage actually look like? If we want to experience what God had intended for us all along, what we need to do is go back to the source and say, what does God's idea for marriage actually look like? So we're going to open it up. We're going to be in Genesis chapter 2 just for a second. Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. It's going to be on the screen. But God creates the world in Genesis 1 and 2. And as God creates the world, he creates the land and the sea, the birds, the animals, the fish, the plants, the sky, light, sun, moon. God creates all of it, and then he creates Adam. And God looks at creation, and he says it's good. But as he focuses on Adam, he notices it in 2:18. He says, the Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. What he doesn't say is it's not good for all men to be alone. What he does not say is it's not good for all women to be alone. What he says, this is directed to Adam. He says, the man, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. So imagine creation. It's so hard for us sometimes. But imagine creation. God creates everything and he puts Adam in the middle and he empowers Adam. Adam gets to name things. He gets to ascribe identities to all of these different things. And God looks and he goes, your best friend's a llama. I need to change this. Like, there's something not right, not balanced. I need to create. So what God does is amazing. He creates a wife. He creates a wife because they both have qualities that God can be attributed to. Both of them have qualities. And as they come together, God says, this is good. This is good. Man and woman, wife, marriage, this is good. Look what it says in verse 24. Just a couple verses later. So it says this. That is why a man leaves his father and mother. Can I get an amen on that at all for anybody? Okay. That's why a man leaves his father and mother. He leaves mama's house and is united to his wife. And they become, say this word with me, one flesh. God's economy is so different than our economy. You know, in our economy, in our world, or math for us, 1 + 1 = what? 2. But God says, when God created marriage, he says, I'm going to do something different. I'm going to do something special. I'm going to do something not yet seen. I'm going to create something where 1 + 1 = 1. That's mysterious. How does that happen? How does that work? Some of you are married. You say, it doesn't happen and it doesn't work. But it does. It does in God's economy. How God created marriage at the very beginning, he created it to be a metaphor. He created it to point to something greater. So there's a temptation for all of us today, and the temptation is this, to write off God's definition of marriage. That's the temptation. And you may say, well, no, it's not. Not for me. Like, I want what God wants. You know, the reality is we want what we want. Something I learned in seminary, it's the difference, two different ways of how to study the Bible. One of them is called exegesis. One of them is called eisegesis. Exegesis, E-X, means to pull out. So exegesis means what we do is we come to scripture, we open it up, we read it, we understand it, we say, God, what was your original intention for this? What did you mean? What were you trying to communicate? And when we understand it, then we look at our lives and we try to apply it. Eisegesis is the opposite. Eisegesis is, I have an idea of what I believe marriage should be. Eisegesis is, I have an idea of what I want. Or what I need, or what I deserve. Eisegesis is I have all of these things, preconceived notions, definitions, experiences. I have all of this stuff so that when I go to scripture, I'm going to open it up and look for things that fit what I already believe. That's dangerous. It's dangerous. So what we're going to do today is we're going to unpack what does God say marriage actually is? Because if we understand what God's definition of marriage is, it can change and transform not just our marriages, but our lives. So that's why we're going to dive in. That's why this is so important. So marriage, this is so important. Genesis chapter 2. Marriage is a creation of God. This, if you grew up in church, this was not on your felt board for creation day. It was not God created the sun and the stars and the moon and the animals and the water and marriage. You didn't have a marriage one. But often we miss it. God created Adam and he created Eve and he brought them together. God created marriage. This is why that's significant. If God created it, there's a purpose for it. If God created it, there's an intention for it. If God created it, there is a right way that it ought to exist. So to build off of this and to understand this, we're actually going to go towards the end of the Bible. We're going to go to a book called Ephesians, and it was the Apostle Paul. We actually just talked about the Apostle Paul in the last series. He was a man, he was a Jewish man that persecuted brand new Jesus followers. That was his role. He tried to quash this movement that Jesus started, and God actually got a hold of his life. He got a hold of his heart, and he said, Paul, his name was Saul. He changed it to Paul. He says, Saul, now Paul, I am calling you to take my message, my gospel, the news about me, Jesus, to the world, but particularly to non-Jewish people, of which many of them lived in Ephesus. So the letter that we're going to read is Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus that is describing this is how marriage ought to be. And here's what he says, Ephesians 5, starting in verse 31. He quotes the passage we just read. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. We just read that. What Paul is saying, this is important, as this intro, Paul is saying, I'm not telling you something new, I'm telling you something old. I'm telling you something at the very beginning, at the very dawn of creation, marriage hasn't changed. But we have. So Paul is taking his group back. He's taking the Ephesian church back, and he's starting there, and then he says this, this is a profound mystery. Marriage is a mystery. It is so mysterious. It's like, how does 1 + 1 equal? That doesn't, I don't understand. It doesn't compute. But he breaks it down and he says, but I'm talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. He's articulating this is what a Christian marriage, this is what a marriage that's built on the foundation of Jesus actually looks like. But marriage in itself as a creation of God was always designed to be a metaphor, to point to a greater relationship, to point to the person of Jesus. That's how it started. That's how it still is today. That's how it always will be. It will always point to the person of Jesus. So this is significant. This is really significant because that is not the approach that most of us take on marriage. It's not. We talked about exegesis, eisegesis. I'm going to tell you how most of us go in from an eisegesis perspective. Most of us enter into marriage with these things in mind. What do I want in a spouse? What do I want? What's on the menu? What can I choose for me? What fits me? What do I prefer? What do I like? What do I need? What about this one? What makes me happy? What makes me feel fulfilled? What makes me feel good, or what makes me feel whole? Do we have chemistry? What void does this person fill in my heart or in my life? Most of us, as we approach marriage, it is this me-centered approach. And what God is saying, and Paul is saying to this Ephesian church, that's not how it started. How it started was marriage was supposed to be a metaphor. It's supposed to be this beautiful thing that builds and points towards something greater. But I love the fact that he uses the word mystery. So mystery, the actual word comes from the Greek word mysterion. And mysterion's a unique word because it means like a secret, like it's a surprise or it's a mystery. That's where we get our word mystery. He says it's a surprise, but it can only be revealed by God. So it's this revelation, something that God has intended for his people. He says marriage, as you unpack marriage, as you understand it, as you live it out, as it puts itself on display, what you will see is marriage. There's a secret underneath it, and it's all about me, and it's always been about me since the very beginning of the world. But it's a secret. It's a mystery. It's something that outside of this room, something outside of the church, something outside of an understanding or a submission to Scripture that people don't get. So we try to define it, or our world tries to define it, or our culture tries to define it. And they say, this is what a marriage is, or this is what it ought to be. And God's going, I already did that. already did that. But because it's a mystery, because it's for my people, because I'm revealing to them what I am at work doing, and it's all pointing to the person of Jesus. If you remove him, you'll miss it. That's why he uses that word, mysterion. So here's the thing. That's not the approach that most of us take, because that doesn't sound fun. Does it? That doesn't sound exciting. It doesn't sound romantic. It doesn't sound euphoric. You're saying my marriage is meant to just be all about Jesus? Yes. Well, then why get married? This is about me. This is about what I want. This is about what I can glean, what I want to fill. And God goes, it's all about Jesus. And what's funny is all of the things that we go into seeking for or hoping for cannot actually be provided by our spouse. They can only be provided by the person of Jesus. And God is saying, that is the point. That's why marriage, I've instituted this, I've created this thing to invite you in so that as you experience it horizontally, you may better understand my relationship with you vertically, between God and us. It's funny, our culture almost takes on marriage as a redemptive thing. Like this is going to redeem some sort of brokenness in my life. God goes, wrong, that's my job. Marriage is intended to point to that. So here's the thing, the Ephesian church and the culture that existed in Ephesus is just like the culture today. Just as much as people today head into marriage with those type of notions or those type of questions or those types of desires, the Ephesian church and the Ephesian people were exactly the same way. So if this feels contrary to you, or if this feels contrary to what you've always been told or what you've desired, guess what? The Bible's definition of marriage has always contradicted Scripture. Or the Bible's definition, I said that wrong. The Bible's definition of marriage has always contradicted culture. They're different. So part of today and part of week one is unpacking what is the Bible's definition of marriage. So to kind of illustrate some of this is just fun. I figured I'd share a little bit about my journey, how I ended up getting married to my wife. I remember in college, I was so excited about college. I went to like a smaller high school in a pretty rural town. There were not a lot of women that I was interested in, and probably more so, there were not a lot of women that were interested in me. So it was a relatively small pond. And so I went to college, and I'm like, what's the biggest college within like 2 hours? I found Grand Valley, and I went, done, good deal, I'll hit it. So I went to Grand Valley, I went in, I'm like, finally, I'm fishing in a big pond, right? It feels like the ocean. Do you know, I struggled in my dating game so badly, it was pathetic. Like here's how I wrote it exactly. I said, I will be the first to tell you, when I was in college, my dating game sucked. I was horrible at it. Like I just wasn't good. I don't know if it's a skill you develop or a quality you inherit, but I didn't get either. So I remember people would ask me and they'd be like, hey, how's life going or whatever, you know, like that close inner circle. And this was my answer. I actually said this out loud multiple times. I said, I'm doing great. I feel like God is for me in every area of my life except relationships. And in that one, he is actively opposed. I was just like, there's no way it could go this bad unless God is involved working against me. That's honestly how I felt. I was just getting frustrated. So what was funny is how I met Shannon, right before, like a month and a half before, I remember I had this kind of duel with God and I said, I'm sick of fighting for this. I'm not good. Like nobody likes playing a game that you always lose at, right? Eventually you just quit the game. So I remember saying to God, I quit the game. This isn't fun anymore. I don't like it. If you've called me to be single, if you're going to work against me, I'll just embrace it. I'll just lean in. I had this image. I was like, you know, I just want to throw a backpack on. I want to move to Ireland, and I'm just going to go town to town to town to town. I'm just going to go, whatever. You know, this is my life. This is what you've called me to, Lord. That was kind of what I resorted to. And so I think God was up in heaven. I think he was looking down at me, and I think he went, I just feel bad for him. So I'm going to help him out. I'm going to step in. So here's how Shannon and I met. We were set up on a blind date by a pastor. You know how boring it sounds saying that out loud? And it's not just like it gets worse. Like we were set up by a pastor. Shannon's dad is a pastor. My dad is a pastor. And now I'm a pastor. And it's as if God is like, you know what? I just want to remind you every day for the rest of your life that I was involved in your marriage. True? Not true, Shan? I mean, it's true. That's how it is. I will be the first one to tell you, Shannon has been the best gift that God has ever given me. the best gift. It was like, I remember even our wedding day. I mean, it was just, it was like, how am I getting this deal? Like, God, you are so good. I thought you were so opposed to me for so long, and yet you were for me in ways that I just couldn't anticipate ahead of time. But I'll say this. One of the things that the guy that set us up used to say to me early on in mine and Shannon's relationship is he said this, marriage is one of the most sanctifying processes that a man can ever go through. And it's not just a man, I mean, it's anybody. But as he was coaching me, just as a young man, I remember him saying over and over and over, David, marriage is one of the most sanctifying processes you could ever go through. I didn't understand that. I didn't get it. I didn't know what that means. But now that we're over 5 years into marriage, I have a much better idea. Because as much as Shan has been this amazing treasured gift that I've received from God, like I brought a lot of junk into our marriage that I didn't remember existed. I wasn't aware of it. Here's certain things. I didn't know how selfish I actually was. And it begins to come up day after day after day after day. When I think I'm going to get something that I deserved or earned or worth, what it's like, man, I didn't realize how much I'm me-focused all the time. This was another surprise to me. I didn't know how broken I actually was. I didn't realize how much grace would be required to give on such a regular basis. I didn't realize how much forgiveness I was in need of on an even more frequent basis. It's like over and over, day after day, season after season in marriage, it's like I'm getting a better and better understanding of God's desire to use marriage as a metaphor that points to an even greater relationship, and that's the person of Jesus. There's like an undoing that has happened in my heart as God goes, okay, I want to go a little bit deeper, and then I want to go a little bit deeper, and I want to go a little bit deeper. And over the years, it's just gotten deeper and deeper and deeper. My understanding of the mystery of the creation of marriage by God. It has been a gift. It's been an extraordinary gift, but we often emphasize the gift and we forget the giver. The giver has a plan, and he has a purpose, and he has a desire, and an invitation for us to step into this thing called marriage so that we might even have a different or better or fuller understanding of who God is. But this is why I said we're going to do a whole sermon just on singleness. It's the thing that points to the real thing. That's the whole purpose. That's the whole focus. We all have access to the real thing, which is a relationship with Jesus. But this thing called marriage that many of us are in is designed to point us in that direction. This is why so many people's wedding day and marriages look different. You know what I'm talking about? I want to articulate it. So a wedding is all focused around one day. I sit down with a lot of couples that desire to be married. I've done a lot of weddings in the last few years as a pastor. And so my first meeting with a couple, I usually do too. My first meeting, I say this probably four or five different times. I say, I care so much more about your marriage than I do your wedding. And that usually hits people different. It's like, what? It's like the same thing. Nope, not the same thing. Not the same thing at all. Because a wedding is one day. Here's other parts or other components of a wedding. It's an event. This is something that people participate in, like you show up or you witness or you watch. It's more passive. It's like, ta-da, here it is, and then it goes away. Another thing here is it's a transaction, right? Man leaves mom and dad's house. Woman leaves mom and dad's house. They leave family relationships to form this brand new, beautiful new thing. One plus one now equals one new thing. There's a transaction that takes place. Here's another one. It's about what you get. You should see some of my wedding day photos with my mouth just gaping wide open. Like, she picked me? It was awesome. It's actually, I have some of my favorite pictures, my mouth hanging wide open. I mean, I was late to stuff because I was like, What? This is awesome. I can't believe it. I was so concerned. I was like, what I get? This is a home run. And then the last one was at someone else's cost. Isn't it true? So many weddings are at the cost of someone else. Not every wedding. But there's often gifts that people give, or there's gifts that parents give or provide for it. There's so much that goes into it that other people incur the cost of. A marriage is totally different. A marriage is not one day. A marriage is for life. This is how God intended it and designed it from the very beginning. It's not about an event that you passively watch or partake in. It's about an experience that you are actively engaged in all the time. It's not about a transaction. It's about transformation. God says, in marriage, in this construct of marriage, I am transforming you to be more like me. It's not a transaction. It's not once we do it or once we say it or once we exchange or once we sign, we're done. God goes, no. Marriage is about transforming over time. It's not about what you give. Now it becomes about what you get. Now it's what you give. Now it's what costs you. And that's the last one. It's not someone else's cost. It's the cost of yourself. Do you see the difference between weddings and marriages? This category is so difficult. It's why half of marriages don't make it. Because you look at that and you go, that's costly. That's difficult. That's different than I anticipated. That's not what I think I need. That's not what I hoped for. And yet God says, yeah, but the purpose of marriage is to point to a greater reality, and it's me. So I love this. Marriage is a mystery. Marriage is a metaphor, and I want to illustrate how closely connected weddings and marriages are to our relationship with Jesus, the ultimate pointing of the metaphor. Look at this. Let's substitute wedding and marriage to now Jesus on the cross and a relationship with Jesus. Jesus on the cross was a day. It's a day in history that took place. It was an event. People were there. People participated. There were different roles. There were onlookers or witnesses, just like a wedding celebration. There was a transaction that took place between God and us. And Jesus said, I'm willing to pay. I'm willing to cover their sin, their guilt, their shame, their brokenness. I'm willing to pay and pay in full. What you get that day is about what we received because of Jesus. It was salvation. What we could do on our own was nothing. But what he could do on our behalf restored what was broken to the point that we had access to our heavenly Father again. And then this last one, it was at someone else's cost. Jesus paid for it. He paid for it. So there was a day that this took place, but now there's an invitation, and through marriage, this comes alive. But marriage points to the real thing, and the real thing is what we have access to. The real thing is this, a life with Jesus. It's a relationship with him. It's not an event that we go to one day a week on Sundays. It's not something we attend on Christmas and Easter. It's an entire experience that God has invited us into that transforms us. That the longer we're with him, the closer we are to him, the more we change, just naturally, we transform to look like him. It's not about what we get anymore. Now it's about what we give. Jesus looked at his disciples and he said, pick up your cross and follow me. Your life is no longer yours. Now it's buried and found in mine. And here's the deal, that if it's buried in Christ, that means it resurrects with him. That you get a new life. It's that new equation. And the last one, it costs you. It costs you. Marriage is a metaphor. It points to the greater reality of Jesus. What Jesus did on the cross for us and the invitation to relationship that he has for all of us. Matthew 22, verse 30, it says, in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like angels in heaven. The reason marriage does not exist in heaven is because heaven is when we will experience what marriage pointed to the entire time. And it's something we have access to today. Jesus, all throughout Scripture, all throughout the Gospels, Jesus refers to himself as the groom and his church, us, the people, you and me, as his bride. So we're going to unpack for the rest of this series, what does that look like? How do we love our spouses like Jesus loves our spouses? How do we love ourselves like Jesus loves ourselves? How do we live and focus our relationship, our lives on the relationship that we have with Jesus? Because it changes everything. Marriage is a metaphor that points to the real thing. Don't miss the real thing that we have access to. I just want to put this picture up. I love this picture of the cross. It's a reminder that he did it. That the transaction, the day, all of it, it's done. But the invitation exists today. Some of you, your marriages are horrible. Some of you are lonely. You haven't yet been married and crave to. Some of you have been divorced. Some of you divorced multiple times. Some of you are widowed. Some of you are broken. Some of you don't have hope. Somebody in first service just came up to me. Somebody I've been walking with for a couple months, and he said, it's going to end in divorce. And I can't do anything about it. I don't understand each and every one of your marriages, but Jesus does. And the invitation he's inviting you to is to experience him. And he promises it'll change everything. So here's three questions I just want to close with. Question number one, does your approach to marriage match the metaphor that God designed it to be? Does your approach, does your vision, does your dream, does it match God's? Number two, it goes like this. Are you willing to let God rewrite your love story? Some of you, this is the thing you hold on to most. You say, this is what I want to see. This is how I want it to end. I don't want to change. I don't want to give. I've already given up, whatever it is. Are you willing to release control over something you care about so much to God and allow him to rewrite it his way? So the first two are easy. Those are yes or no questions. The last one is probably the most difficult. How can you emulate Jesus in your present circumstances? If you're married and you've been married for a couple years, married for a couple decades, divorced, single, widowed, how can you emulate Jesus in your present circumstances? Because from the very beginning of creation, it has always pointed to one thing, to one person, as the person of Jesus. So I'd love to close just in prayer. Father, we just come before you right now. I know there's a lot of marriages that are hurting. I know there's a lot of marriages that are broken. I know there's a lot of marriages that are going through challenges or struggles or issues right now that nobody anticipated. Father, I just pray that you'd be near right now to those marriages, especially those that are struggling. Father, even as we look forward to this marriage event this coming Friday that just invests in marriages, I pray, Father, that we would open our hearts and open our marriages and allow you to lead them and you be the center. Father, over the last 18 or 19 months, we've heard from so many people, so many marriages who are struggling and broken and not doing well. And I just pray through your Holy Spirit that you would bless them, that you would remind them that you are in the business of not just making bad things good, but in making dead things come back to life. So Father, where hope has been lost, I pray that you would restore it. Father, where brokenness has occurred, I pray that you bring healing. Father, where separation exists, I pray that you would bring unity. And I pray that you would continue to make us more and more and more like you each and every day. We love you. And we thank you for Jesus. We pray this in his name. And everybody said together, amen.
Amen. Well, if you would please join us and stand. We're just going to use this time as reflection. Take some time. And if you don't know the song, that's okay. Just sing what you can. And let's just take inventory of our hearts. What's a priority maybe above God? The song, the whole message is there is no one higher than our God. And not only is that true in our lives, but that's just factual, that he is so much more powerful than anything or anyone else in this world. So let's sing this together.
Thank you.
Amen. Amen. So glad that you joined us today. Excited for the remainder of this series. And just like I said earlier, regardless of your relational status, regardless of where you're at in life or what it looks like, this series can add so much value to our lives. And this is why we really feel like God led us to this for this season. So I hope you'll come back. I hope you'll join us for next week for part two. How we often close here at Frontline is with a benediction, which just means blessing. So I'd love to invite you just to extend your hands as a posture of reception. Just as I read this over us. Brothers and sisters of Frontline Church, you are loved far more than you could ever imagine by a God that desires a close relationship with you. His name is Jesus. He died on a cross with you in mind. He resurrected 3 days later, and he desires to live in and through your life and your marriage today if you will let him. He can change anything, but first let him change our hearts. Amen? Amen. Amen. Thank you for coming. We love you. Be blessed, and we'll see you next week.